Hello and welcome along to round 9 of our World Game Live sessions here at SBS. I'm your host, Lucy Zelic. It's fantastic to have your company, as it is the gentleman to my left here. Welcome back, our regular panellist. You are going to see this man every single Monday, dammit. Nick Stoll, a.k.a. Stollage. Stollage, first of all, congratulations.
I'm actually not here next Monday. Sorry, I had to break that to you. Yeah, I'm going to a wedding, so just...
What do you mean? You won't see me
next Monday, unless you're at the wedding. Well done.
Is someone getting married on the Monday, or you're just deciding
no.
to have an extended, extended period of...
Yeah, so the wedding is on the Gold Coast on the Saturday, and then it was cheaper to fly back on the Monday, so that's why I'm coming back on the Monday. Yes, that's it. So anyway, it's very good to be here this Monday, and good luck to the happy couple.
Well, good luck to me for next Monday then.
Yeah. Listen.
So you get the call up, and this is how you repay us. You just don't turn up next Monday because you're a tight ass. Are you flying Tiger?
Oh yeah, I don't even know who, it was the Skyscanner sort by cheapest flights, absolute, no baggage, no seatbelt, whatever, it's all on there.
Basically, just hope to God that you get there. So, yeah. I will say congratulations on becoming a regular panellist, and so much of it had to do with me and, the response also that we had.
All that to do with me! I want to say congratulations to you, but it was really me who did the hard work.
It's actually true. I wanted you on here full time. We finished last week, and I said, that's it, Stollage, you're a permanent panellist here, whether you like it or not, and I think the fans like it too, guys. I think he's done a fantastic job. He's a very valuable
thanks, fans.
Here
some guy didn't know who I was last week.
No, don't you worry. Now Richard, I believe his name was Richard. I've got a good memory. Dick will remember who you are. Good stuff. Thank you for your question last week, Dick. But we hope that you're back with us again. We hope that you're all back with us again on this Monday from wherever you're watching. It is great to have your company. If you are joining in via Twitter, make sure you use the hashtag SBS the World Game to get your questions into us so that Nikki and I can get onto them.
Yeah.
There is a lot to get onto on today's show, by the way.
So
it doesn't matter that it was an international break and that stupid competition the UEFA Nations League was on. I'm finding it difficult to get enthused about this competition, Stollage.
What about the people of Gibraltar? Their first ever competitive win.
Yeah, they're buzzing. But I just feel like UEFA are trying desperately to create some kind of interest in these friendly international matches. And for me, I feel like it's just a little bit dour.
Am
I being harsh?
I think we need to give it time to see how it's going to go because, right now, they're just what we're going to see is the implication of these games further down the line. So, as these people get relegated from their groups, they will find then qualifying harder, and so we'll see teams missing out on European Championships and World Cups because of where they are in the groups at this stage. So this is like a pre-qualifying thing. So I think there will be interest eventually. It's just got to. It's going to take a little while to materialise.
All right.
A bit like Usain Bolt's football talent. It's just going to hopefully take a bit of while to materialise.
I'm really glad you mentioned Usain Bolt. And a lot of people are mentioning Usain Bolt off the back of what he managed to do at the weekend against MacArthur. And he scored 2 goals. He was sitting on a hat-trick. It tastes like poison, all of this coming out of my mouth right now. Because let me tell you something now. And she is 68 today, by the way. My mother does not have Facebook.
Happy birthday.
I will wish Mrs. Zelic a happy birthday today. She's 68. She could have scored against MacArthur with the greatest of respect to all of those MacArthur players, who are not full-time footballers, by the way. So, anyway, that's all I'm going to say on that. Actually, there's a lot more to say.
There's a lot more going to say on that, yeah.
I want to hear what you have to say about Usain Bolt.
Usain Bolt, all right.
And him scoring those 2 goals against MacArthur, in which my 68-year-old mother, happy birthday to her again today, could have done.
Well, I want to say that it was a very exciting moment when he did score, especially that first goal. The second goal was a bit of just a tap in, whatever. So the first goal.
Why was it exciting?
Because it was you didn't know if he was ever going to score. And then it happened and he hit it and you're like, oh my God, he's actually scored. And then it was going around the world, got 6 million views on Twitter and all this kind of stuff. So it was a huge thing that happened in a football stadium in Southwest Sydney. So good publicity, got it out there, all good, right? But what we have to remember is, anyone who watched the full game knows that this guy can't play A-League level, anytime soon, I'm going to say. Because, at the end of the day, why do we train kids from such a young age to work on their touch, right? Why do we train from, 7 years old kids juggling? Because it's so hard to develop a professional level touch on the ball.
You can't just wake up one day and decide to be a professional footballer.
Yeah.
I'm incensed by this. can, and you think it's hilarious. Everyone finds when I get so worked up about these Facebookers and Twitter users joining us, they find it so amusing that I get so angry, but I find it so disrespectful that you think you could just wake up one day on a whim and decide to be a professional footballer. It cannot happen. It should not be allowed to happen. One thing I'm so infuriated by is that everybody in this country, and it's also within this football community and pundits, respected pundits, that are coming in and saying, oh, this is a great thing for the league. This is fantastic. Great for marketing. Can we just actually start to be honest about this? Because it's not doing anything for the good of our game. Stolich.
I don't think it's doing anything.
We need honesty about this.
I don't think it's doing great things for the league. What I think it's doing great things for is it's doing great things, and I'll say as like a journalist, it's doing great things for the media around the league. So for example, our most watched video of this week was Usain Bolt's goal, right? That was our most watched video. So I think for the media...
So is this what we're doing it for? So this is what we as an organisation are doing it for? It's what Fox is doing it for? It's what Bean is... Whoever is covering Usain Bolt, are you telling me now that this is why we're doing it, Stolich? It's just so that we can go back to our managers at the end of the week and say, oh, we had 6 million views on this video. That cannot be for the good of the game.
Well, partly. I think that is definitely partly why I'll do it. And it is not for the good of the game. But this... So this is the thing. I think that, you know, who would have watched a Mariners preseason game before like this thing happened? No one, or very few people, a couple thousand people.
It wouldn't have been broadcast.
Yeah,
that's the point.
So, you know, it's got out there. They've really maximized the exposure. But I think the clear problem is that his football intelligence in terms of his positioning, his decision making is nowhere near good enough. His touch is nowhere near good enough. You know, there was the example where at the very early on in the game, he was through on goal and his touch was incredibly heavy. So for all the speed he has, because his decision making is not good enough and his touch is not good enough, it negates all the effect of being that fast, right? The other thing that was, you know, you would see the ball would come across, there was a cross where it'd come from the left-hand side and all he had to do was kind of side foot it with the right, and because he's all left foot, he would try an outside of the foot and he completely miss it. So I think it is interesting to see. It is keeping us interested in that storyline. But I do think that I'm glad it's not happening at my club, for example, because it's just not good enough. It's just like, that's not who you want as a starting striker. If this was anyone else, you'd go, oof, that was a, like, that guy's touch was incredibly bad.
And that's where he needs to be and how he should be judged.
Yeah.
He should be judged like any other player that's coming into the A-League. And the biggest issue that I have, let me just make it clear, I respect Usain Bolt enormously for what he's done in his sprinting and his athletic career. I think it is remarkable. This is the fastest man on the planet that we are talking about. But can we start to treat this league, which we call a professional league, by the way, which players growing up in this country are killing themselves for to be a part of, can we start to treat it as it is and show it the respect that it deserves? This is not showing the league respect, and this is why I have a big problem with it. Should he, Facebookers and Twitter users, be given a professional contract or not? It'll be interesting to see what you guys have to say. There's also another article that came out via the World Game, and it's doing the rounds, by our very own Dave Lewis. Usain Bolt's football future could be decided in a matter of days, with Football Federation Australia holding the key to whether the Jamaican sprint king remains with Central Coast Mariners or possibly jets off to try his luck elsewhere. So the club's hierarchy want the governing body to lavish $1 million from their marquee funds to help finance the A-League contract for Bolt.
Yeah. I mean, here's how I look at it. Bolt is good for marketing in terms of it gets the league exposure. Now, whether it gets it exposure as in, you know, like a lot of the things I saw, I know MacArthur, Southwest Sydney, whatever their name is, I know they, you know, obviously aren't a professional team, but when it was going around the world and I was looking at a lot of like the global headlines, there was like Usain Bolt scores after awful defending, right? So is that positive for the league? Not necessarily, because it's actually saying, oh my God, like, what is this that he's scoring in? I just think it's better for the league if it shows that he's not good enough to make it, because it shows like, yeah, no, this is a professional league. You need to be like of a decent standard to play in this league. So I think if FA are going to put in money, it can't be from the football budget, but if they decide that it's from the marketing budget, so if you're going to spend X amount on marketing and you decide to take some of that, because this is a marketing exercise.
But you can't market the league based on one player. This is
no.
The problem, Stolich.
No.
Marketing the league has been the big problem for the A-League in the last 2, 3, 4, maybe even seasons.
And I think that's why they were very conscious to keep Usain Bolt out of any, like, you know, we saw the really cool ad that they did last week that they dropped. Usain Bolt was not in
great
that
ad,
right?
Way.
Yeah, Usain Bolt was not in that. There was no mention of him. It wasn't even like, you know, sometimes in these ads, they try and hint at it by showing like a jersey or something. They didn't do that. I don't think they had him at the launch today. So, you know, they are still trying to very much, I think, to FFA's credit, keep it focused on Bolt. And I think from everything I've heard, that they won't, they're happy for the Mariners to, like, it's your club, do your thing. If you want to, if this is the avenue you want to go down, okay. We will not support it in a financial way.
Yeah.
And I think maybe that's probably the right thing to do. I think you go, okay, listen, this has been huge for the Mariners in terms of global recognition, but at the end of the day, you are still a football club. And, you know, even stuff like, you've got to think that there was talk I saw on Twitter, like, you know, this is one of the biggest moments in Mariners history. No, guys, come on. You've gone to grand finals. You've won A-League titles. Like, you've played in the Asian Champions League.
That's what we need the club to be striving for. And let's be honest, the club have signed some really decent players. The addition of Ross McCormack as well.
Very good.
That is huge. We saw that he did for Melbourne City last season. I thought he was fantastic. And I remember urging Melbourne City to try and keep McCormack on their roster, but they had no control over it because Villa stepped in. So, and it's also going to be interesting to see what happens to Villa, you know, now that they recently sacked their coach, whether or not McCormack gets recalled. That'll be fascinating to see how that plays out. But they look like they're actually going to try to be genuinely competitive this year. And the addition of Bolt has just, it's diminished not just the league and what it should represent, but it's also diluted the Mariners brand. And I think that's dangerous territory to be entering into, particularly when you have struggled for so many years and you're desperate to play finals football again. The club and the fans deserve better than that. That's all I want to say. That's my last point.
Well, I wonder, I mean, and maybe people tell us, like, Mariners fans, like, because, like I said, I don't want it to happen to my club. I don't mind it happening because it's kind of, like, interesting to see. You know, I wouldn't have watched Mariners versus MacArthur Rams on a Friday night, but I was watching, I was checking it out, you know. I was on the night shift, so I did have to do it for work reasons, but I was watching and it was kind of interesting and I was talking to people about it, but that is not who I want to be my starting striker. And I know they've tried to play him out wide, but it looked like after a couple of minutes they decided, no, we're going to play him as the number nine. It was clear they were trying to get him a lot of opportunities to score. I love Usain Bolt for everything he did. I think he's a great person. I like the way he interacted with the kids at the game. I've liked him since 2008 when I first saw him at the Olympics. But, I mean, man, you're not a footballer. Like, at the end of the day, like, you just don't... It takes years and years and years of training. It takes years of the first touch, the football intelligence, the decision-making. I mean, come on,
if
like...
If it was that easy, then we'd all be professional footballers. Yeah. Let's be honest. The Zelic gene did not extend to me. I can kick a ball around, but I'm not going to pretend to go and be a professional.
But also, it's not going to happen. The big clubs wouldn't be setting up academies for 6 and 7 and 8 year olds trying to get people in that early because they know that kids need to be working on it for years before they reach the professional level.
Can I please read out this funny comment via Facebook from Ray Marley? As soon we will give a contract to Winks to play in the league. What else is coming?
Yeah, I mean, at a certain point, like, this is the thing. Exposure.
Oh, I like it, Ray.
Exposure is good, but at a certain point, like, you have to... the league itself has to be what's interested to us, not which celebrity sports star is going to come in and join us.
Michael Mack, Tiger Woods to Western Sydney.
Tiger Woods to Western Sydney. Yeah, I mean, we could have, you know, Justin Gatlin, all these other sprinters.
Oh, my God. I've gotten so worked up over this topic. Every time it comes up, I feel my blood boil. And so I have to apologise if I've come across as a bit aggressive today when we talk about this, which I was very fired up before we even went to air. But
it's
I've reached a point now where I think we just need to start being honest and stop dressing this up as what a great thing for the league, because it's not. And I personally don't think it is. You want to talk about marketing, you want to talk about getting fans to a pre-season game and broadcasting a match that potentially wouldn't have been broadcast before. Big deal. What is it doing for the growth of the sport? What's it doing for the development of footballers in this country? Nothing. So let's leave it at that. Let's move on to actual footballers now. Footballers that are, they're in Q8. They're our very own Socceroos, and they're taking on Q8 in the early hours of the morning. That's going to be a tough slog to get up for that one, 3:30, although I'm used to horrific times, no schedule. But I want to talk a little bit about Graham Arnold. We've seen Tommy Dorgic come out and speak very positively of him. Of course, him being reunited with his former coach. I think, you know, this is going to be a huge test for Graham Arnold, but one that he's very up for. He said that people will be surprised. He is looking to basically play some exciting football with the Socceroos.
Yeah.
Just what that means remains to be seen. We'll find out tomorrow, I guess. But your thoughts, first of all, Stolich, on what you expect?
It's hard to know what to expect. I guess everything coming out of the camp is good. You know, you hear the players talking about, yep, we're going to play this proactive attacking style of football. We're going to try and get lots of players like into the box. And so we're hearing all the right things, but of course, you know, when the new boss comes in, you're always going to say, ah, yeah, it's great times, because you're fighting for places. You're fighting, you know, so let's see. Kuwait away, not the easiest game, also not the hardest game. So we can't extrapolate too much from this game. But hopefully going forward, we see the Socceroos team that we want to see, an attacking team that's creating lots of chances, you know, in control. It's going to be very interesting to see how those players who thrived under Arnold at the Mariners, so you're talking about Rogic, Sainsbury, yeah, even Matt Ryan, those type of guys.
Mustafa Amini,
you know, yeah. Will, you know, someone like Bernie Abini be back in the fold? Because he was under Arnold, I think, both at Sydney FC and at the Mariners.
Right.
So, you know, it's going to be interesting if those players really thrive. I think, for example, Rogic, I think he's one, probably our most talented player, but are we getting the best out of him in the last couple of years? I feel like we haven't been.
So as in the coaching staff?
Yeah.
Those positions at that time, they haven't, because we didn't see the best of him at the World Cup under Van Marwijk,
no,
that's for sure. And I think so much of that had to do, Stolich, with Van Marwijk's style of play.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't really seem to fit like a very... Rogic type of player who... He needs the team to be high up the pitch and getting the ball a lot. So that was hard. Sometimes it's been hard to accommodate him and Moy at the same time, as well as like a holding midfielder. So very interesting to see how it will all play out. You know, I think I'm expecting that they'll beat Kuwait.
Yeah.
I don't think that's a crazy thing to expect. I'm not expecting them to smash them 5-0. And if they don't, I'm not going to be disappointed. But you would, you're more looking at the performance at this stage.
Well, the question is also, where are the goals going to come from?
Yeah.
Because scoring in open play has been a real issue for the Socceroos of late. But before we get to that, I want to go through some of the faces that we've seen reintroduced to the Socceroos fold, or perhaps getting the call up for the first time that we haven't noticed before. I mentioned Mustafa Amini, he's back in there. Martin Boyle, playing for Hibernian in Scotland as well. That's another interesting one. But then you've got Thomas Deng with Melbourne Victory, another very exciting player. I've got a lot of time for Thomas Deng. I think he's a quality talent. Dennis Genru also, who's playing at PC Zwolle in the Netherlands. But then other names also springing up. You've also got Awer Mabil, who's doing very good in Denmark. And that seems to be about it in terms of new faces there. Anyone to look out for, Stolich, out of those names? Facebookers, Twitter users, anyone caught your eye there in this current squad?
I'm very interested to see how Arzani goes. Obviously, he was kind of a bit of the lightning bolt of the sorry to say bolt in front of you again, but it was the kind of
right,
the
I've calmed down now, I'm okay.
He was
I'm
the
right.
bit
I'm
of
my medication.
bit of electricity that we had at the World Cup. He came off the bench. Let's see if he starts. I know there's a story on our website right now about him having fitness issues, not being able to play
that?
The full 90.
We're going
to
talk about that.
Yeah, so and he hasn't been playing at Celtic, so you do kind of want to see like, has he developed at all? I think that's going to be quite exciting. But yeah, you're right. Where do the goals come from? We've struggled for so many years. Even under Ange, there was a lot of possession, even a lot of shots. I remember we played Thailand. We had about 25 shots. Mm-hmm. The goals were always struggling to come. And often we were so reliant on Timmy. And, you know, Timmy's not there anymore. Mille's not there anymore. He's got a hat-trick against Honduras. Mm-hmm. So it's really now or never for these guys, like Tommy Juric, like Gianu, these strikers to step up.
I couldn't agree more. Ivan Sragan, Thomas Deng is exciting, can play anywhere across the back four. Back four seems to be an issue for us as well, because we don't necessarily have a settled lineup when it comes to our defence. Stefan Leskovac, Jamie McLaren needs to start. So we didn't see enough from him at the World Cup.
No.
And that's another player that could potentially do a lot of damage for us up front if given the opportunity. He's got the potential, Stolich. Can he deliver, though?
Well, I mean, it remains to be seen at that level. Definitely was delivering for the Roar when he was here in the A-League.
Mm-hmm.
Went to Germany, didn't start a game, struggled there. Went
with Darmstadt.
Yeah. So second division Germany. Then he went to Hibs in the second half of the season, did really well. Scored, I think, 8 goals in 16 games or something like that. Now, I think this season hasn't been doing great. But to be honest with you, I mean, are there any Aussies this season that are really in top form for any kind of the European club out there at the moment. There's a lot of, I mean, so we do a thing on Saturday, well, Sunday and Monday mornings where we'll do like an Aussies Abroad wrap. And to be honest with you, we look through it and a lot of the guys are coming off the bench, you know, or they're playing, but like, for example, Moy plays every week, but his team is really struggling. And it's hard when you're in a team that's right at the bottom to really develop your own form, especially if you're an attacking player. So I don't know, like...
Well, McLaren is injured at the moment, and we've had a few comments come in and reinforce that, but he obviously won't be playing in these friendlies, but he is someone that has been introduced to the Socceroos fold that hasn't quite been given enough of an opportunity to exert some kind of authority in the lineup. Zani, this question, or comment rather, from Hayden Ogilvie, Zani is the best player in the midfield since Kuhl.
Yeah, ooh, potentially. Agreed? I think he has the potential definitely to be at that level. It just, how many players have we seen over the years that had all this potential and it hasn't translated into, you know, there is a big difference between being a star player at 19 and being a world-class player at 25.
Yeah.
And that's going to be the really interesting thing with Zani. I believe he can get to that level.
Case study with Kylian Mbappe, right?
Yeah.
Who is an absolute and utter freak. And
although he's on a different level.
That's a different level. He's world class now at 19.
Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, some players do get to that. Like Messi at 18 was scoring hat tricks against Real Madrid. You know, there are players that do it. But you look at someone like Boyan. Boyan was playing Champions League at 17 years old for Barcelona.
I've got a lot of time for that.
Yeah. And then he's just kind of plateaued out. So, we'll see.
See, we see a lot of that too. Even at SBS, when we've covered, say, the under-17 World Cups,
I've
worked with Foz and Ante Milicic, who both them, in you know, their coaching capacities, have had experience with younger players. And Foz in particular, who's covered a host of these under-17s World Cups, you see it a lot with the Argentinian team, for example. A lot of players at that level who look like the promising future of their senior national team that don't quite get to that level. So it's not completely uncommon.
Yeah.
But important to see the youngsters doing well at that level. Now, a player that is struggling at that level is Daniel Arzani. You touched on it very briefly there about his struggling scenario over at Celtic under Brendan Rodgers. Now, we've had an article go up exclusively on the World Game not all that long ago. Make sure you have a look at it, but I'll read the quick headline and we'll get into it. The clock is ticking on Daniel Arzani's Celtic future with an agreement in place to send the young Australian gun back to parent club Manchester City should he fail to land a first team appearance by December. He has a clause by this that was included in his contract that was stipulated by the citizens that said if he did not get a start in the senior team by December, he could be recalled back to the club and loaned out elsewhere.
Which makes sense.
Now, it does. And Brendan Rodgers has come under fire now. We actually got a couple of quotes from the Gold Coast-based hoops great Willie Wallace, who said this: Arzani is a good little player and Brendan Rodgers disappointed me on that one, with reference to the fact he hasn't started him yet. I quote again, he's saying, it's going to be a while before he plays. Well, why are Celtic paying the wages and not Man City? If I was the board at Celtic, I'd have kicked the manager's ass out the door. Why would you take Arzani for 2 years if he isn't going to play in your team? The kid for me will finish up a better player than James Forrest. Arzani, he's been there since August, still no first team football. Rodgers is adamant that he's not ready yet. Now, whether that is question marks around his fitness, which Rodgers has alluded to, that seems to be a bit of a sticking point. I'm not sure that Rodgers is completely... He's the villain in all of this. If he doesn't believe that Arzani is ready for first team football, then he as the coach is entitled to think that.
Yeah.
Stolich, Facebookers, Twitter users, your thoughts?
I mean, obviously we want to see Arzani start as much as possible. But, you know, if Rodgers thinks he's not ready, then that's going to be Rodgers' opinion. And he's not going to be change his mind when he's trying to keep Celtic at the top. Celtic are already struggling this season, right? Mm-hmm. So it's unlikely that he's going to take what he thinks is a risk on playing Arzani. He's, if anything, he's going to try and be safer. He's going to go back to revert to what he knows, the players he already trusts, the players he thinks can, because there's a lot of talk about can Arzani see out the 90 minutes. And, you know, if you think about it, for whatever reason, I don't know if it was a fitness issue, but oftentimes in Melbourne City, he was subbed off, you know, earlier. He came off, he came on as a sub. So, not sure what's going on there. I believe that Arzani is one of the most talented players that we've had in a very long time. Again, I would like to see him start a lot, but if the coach is not backing you, I think it's good that you have that clause because, you know what? If they're not starting you, go back to City, they'll find you somewhere else to start. And, you know, I'd hope that he would have by now at least be getting a few off-the-bench appearances.
Well, see, the same could be said for, and I will of course be accused of being biased because I'm bringing it back to Liverpool, but it's a big talking point around the club at the moment, and it has to do with Fabinho.
Yep.
Right? Still has not made in the Premier League a start for the club, and he's barely coming off the bench.
Yep.
That. So, and Klopp is maintaining that, it's because he's not ready yet. I mean, we saw that there was quite a delay with Alex Oxlade-Chamberlain when he arrived to the club from Arsenal, and it took a long time for the Ox, who we hope, by the way, is recovering well after his knee injury. But it took a long time for him to feature in the side. So,
yeah.
But the coach, it's at their discretion. And if he doesn't think he can see out the 90 or at least add the value that he needs him to, then it looks like he could be going back.
If I was advising Arzani right now, I'd say do as much as you can in training to impress Rodgers. Do as much as you can. Like if you're scoring, so I think he's playing for the youth team at the moment, the under 23 side. Yeah. Or do as much as you can in those games. If you're scoring all the time, it will become... or creating
make it
undeniable that you have to start, especially if the team's struggling. And you know what, if he still doesn't give you a go, because sometimes it happens, sometimes there are good players and coaches just don't want him at all, and they just never give him a chance. Okay, well, still it's better that you keep pushing, keep giving everything you can in training, because you'll become a better player. Then 6 months later, you'll be a more attractive proposition to the next place that wants to take you out on loan. And I think that's the only thing you can do. You've got to keep making it undeniable that you should be starting.
Some very good points, Stolich. That's why I've made you a permanent panelist.
I make it undeniable that I should be permanent. Also, I think I'm free, so that's also undeniable for the budget.
Well, you're not free next Monday. You're leaving us for a wedding. Anyway, let's get on to the upcoming 14th A-League season, which kicks off in just a few days' time. Of course, the launch occurred here in Sydney this morning for both the A-League and the W-League, which is very exciting stuff. Finally, after this laboriously long off-season / pre-season, we can finally start to get into the professional football. But we've got a really fabulous club-by-club guide for the 2018-19 season up on the World Game website, which you can see in full. But I want to sort of go through each team quite briefly and touch on the key points around them. Adelaide United, under Michael Kurtz, once again. Expectations of how they'll perform. Because when you look at their key signings, they've had some decent players come in. Michael Jakobsen, one of them, coming across from Melbourne City. I was surprised he left City, to be honest. That was a really peculiar move to me because I thought, you know, that's a player you want to hang on to. They've also had Craig Goodwin come back to the Reds. They've got Ben Halloran and Mirko Bolland and Ken Ilso as well. So your thoughts too, Stolich, on how Adelaide will perform. Any Adelaide fans, feel free to chime in.
Yeah, Adelaide fans.
Fifth last season.
I would like to know, Adelaide fans, each and every A-League team, what are you excited about your team?
So we're having mic problems too with my microphone, by the way. So
I'm not sure
what's going on here.
Do you want to speak into my...
Our producers are clearly rubbish. Do you want me to just speak into your neck again?
There
That's
we go.
That's probably going to get a bit weird after a while, but maybe our producers can come here and fix my situation. They should get onto it, otherwise they'll get the sack.
All right.
I'm in a sacking kind of mood, although I have absolutely no authority to sack.
Maybe the bolt ran, like exploded the mic because it was
maybe,
so kind of
maybe.
Fierce. And then...
I like how you keep reminding me of that. See, I've calmed down. I told you I was fine now, and you have to keep bringing me back to it. Anyway, thank you, Stuart Lister, and a host of other people that have told me my mic is shit. But carry on. Adelaide United.
Adelaide United. I think Craig Goodwin being back is a really good thing for them.
Luca Jordine reflects those comments. Goodwin looking very promising. Mike Southam will finish third. Adelaide.
Yeah, okay, very. I think Ben Halloran looked really good. I saw them in the FA Cup semi-final against Bentley Greens. They weren't incredibly impressive. They weren't unimpressive. It was just like a very solid professional performance. So we'll see how they go on. But yeah, I think they'll definitely want to be improving on last season. I think finals football will probably, they'll probably make the finals, yeah.
Jordan Minter. I hope he's taking the piss and doing this just to roll me up. Only thing that excites me about this A-League season is Bolt. Hope he gets a contract in game time. I may as well just take my mic off now deliberately and just leave. Should
I mean, you know what?
Me too.
Maybe Jordan
no.
is a Bolt fan.
No, maybe he's a basketball fan, in which case, you know what? You would have loved him when he was running around like a basket case on an athletic track.
Basket case. He's running pretty good.
He's the fastest man alive. Yep. I mean, he was incredible as a sprinter. Again, I'm starting to sweat. See, this is a real problem for me. I don't want to talk about Usain Bolt anymore.
All right.
I can't do it. I just can't do it.
Yes.
Anyway, Adelaide United.
Yeah, so Adelaide United, I think it's going to be very interesting to see their first game. Big test, Sydney FC at home. You know, you got the more or less they were the best team in the league last season. I know, you know, they didn't go to the grand final, but they performed over the 27 games. They were the best team. So, and they look very good. It's a early preview of the FFA Cup final. So be really good to see Friday night. I'm really looking forward to it. And yeah, I mean, you know, I think that will be a really good indicator about how their season's going to go, where they're at, because it's a very tough challenge first up, but I'm sure they'll be fired up for it.
Next team, and we're going in alphabetical order, Central Coast Mariners. So Mike Mulvey returns for his stint in the A-League after that whole conundrum blew up with Brisbane Roar. Spent some time abroad in Malaysia and things like that, and has now come back for his second stint. Last season, the club finished 10th. And they've been absolutely woful. But key signings for them, Tommy Orr, we've touched on them earlier, Ross McCormick, they've got Aidan O'Neill that's come across, Khalifa Sisse, Michael McGlinchey too, nice to see him back at the club. Matty Simon also makes his return, and Jordan Murray, another promising youngster.
Yeah, now, scored on the in that game as well.
Yes,
I know.
The game in which my mother could have scored in.
Yeah.
But that said, no disrespect to the actual professional footballers that scored in that game. However, big expectations for the Mariners for the first time in a while, based on the signings that they have made. Can you actually see them cracking the six this time, though? Guys, what do you think? Guys and gals.
I do think they will crack the six, because I think if you think about like Mike Mulvey's Brisbane Roar team, when he won the title.
Yeah, Brisbane Roar will be in alphabetical order. That's actually a very good point, and it wasn't in alphabetical order in here. Sorry, apologies for that. I'll get back to that. Go on.
Anyway, guys, don't worry about alphabetical order, all right? This is chaos, all right? Don't worry. This is this is what this show is, all right?
Oh, what a nightmare. Yeah. I should sub myself off, quite frankly, but then there's no one else here. So
no.
You have to carry the show on your own.
I can't do that.
Are they going to crack the six or not? That's what people want to know. Finally, for the first time, they are.
I think they are. Because if you think about it, Mike Mulvey, he's won an A-League title. So you think that he, you know, is a good enough coach to make that happen. They've made good signings in Ross McCormack and Tommy Orr. And, you know, interesting to see, like, Jordan Murray scored a hell of a lot of goals in the NPL, so whether he can do the same. You know, I think Michael McGlinchey is a good thing. Let's see. They finished 10th last season. It can be tough, but and I hope that the Bolt thing is not becoming a distraction from the pre-season preparation that goes on. All right, we're going to have to put a ban on the Bolt word.
Just don't. But, you know what? If you want to piss me off, just mention it.
Yeah.
But if you want me to be in good general spirits and talk about the game in a respectful manner and actually get into the nuts and bolts of what...
Hey, whoa, nuts and about, what? Nuts and... See?
I'm just going to go.
All right.
I'm just going to leave. Brisbane Roar. Obviously, last season they finished sixth. They were elimination finalists.
Yep.
Key signings, Stefan Mork, Adam Taggart, Tobias Mikkelsen.
Yep.
I like the look of Adam Taggart as an addition. Very, very good. Hopefully he has a good season with them, because they need it.
Well, they had the big Mac up front last season, and I thought he was good, but he was 38 years old. Like, you know, it was at a certain point that was starting to show, but I don't know. I wonder...
At a certain point, that was starting to show. Yeah. What, in every game?
Yeah, no, he had moments. He had moments of class, you know.
All right.
He's like the old guy that plays down at the park, you know.
He was good, but I just wish we had him 10 years ago.
Yeah, exactly.
There you go.
So I think the Roar are going to be there or thereabouts, you know, 6th, 5th. I don't see them really pushing for, like, those first kind of top four. So I think they'll probably be around the same spot as last year, 6th, 7th.
6th or 7th. Okay, all right. Let's skip down, because my alphabet seems to be struggling today.
Yep.
Melbourne City.
Yep.
The next team on the agenda. Coach Warren Joyce still there. Last season they finished 3rd, semi-finalist. Key signing, I believe Richie Dillette is injured.
Okay.
Yes, so that's what I've seen. But a couple of other names that may ring a bell to a few people around the traps. Roston Griffiths, Riley McGree, Anthony Caceres, Mark Birraghidi also comes back to Australia as well. We know that he left the Jets to go abroad and has come back again. Thoughts on Melbourne City and how they'll do?
Melbourne City's weird, because like when they started out, you know, you thought they were going to be this kind of big, kind of like the Hollywood FC of the A-League. You know, they have the most money out of everyone in the league.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and early on they were spending like a lot of money on bringing in kind of like top players, whether they be, you know, marquees or whatever. They made really good international signings, you know, Fornaroli and Novillo. I know Fornaroli's still there, and I hope he has a really good season. I think a lot will depend.
He had a tough season last year with all the injuries.
I think a lot will depend on his brilliance, because when he's on form, unstoppable. But I don't know, they're making some signings which I feel like their ambition might have been curved. And I think now they're looking more at, they got Moy, so they got a good young Australian talent, and then sold him to Huddersfield for 10 million or whatever it was. So, and I think that they're doing the same thing with Arzani. I think that's now their motivation as a club, okay, is to get the best of like the young Aussie talent, develop them, and then send them to Europe and kind of like, as I think, that's what it seems like to me.
I would expect that for the City Group, for all of their ambitions, for all of their money and their resources that they have at their disposal, Stolich, I would have thought that winning the league is their first and foremost priority, rather than just being this feeder league that's, you know, bringing in players and selling them off and making the money. They don't need to make the money. They want titles. And with everything that I've just listed, you think that they would be able to do that. But something is missing at that club.
Yeah.
Is it the culture? What is there that you can tangibly articulate is an absentee figure at that club?
I'm not sure. It just seems to me like, based on the signings they're making, it seems like, the ambition is not... They have the money to go out and make like signings, like I would think, like Sydney FC have made, for example, like CM Diong and Adam Lafondra.
So does Lafondra.
Like these kind of players that are still like at a decent age, right? They, you know, probably like 30 or thereabouts, right? They're still playing at a decent level, and they come back. They seem like they're not quite making those signings anymore, you know. And if you think about it, it's not because they have a lack of money or a lack of scouting. So I wonder with Melbourne City this year, I reckon they'll still be in the six, but I think. I do feel like their club is more towards now developing players to send overseas.
Interesting theory. Danny Karchnak. City is not a football club, they're a business. Well, does that feed into what you're saying, Stolich?
They are a business. I mean, that's the thing. If you think about it, they are a franchise of the City Football Group. You know, obviously... Yeah. The Abu Dhabi owners look at this as a way of like, all right, we can spread the City brand everywhere, and then if people support Melbourne City, they'll support Manchester City, and they'll support, you know, New York City, and they have. But I think a lot of it is now they look at it as like, let's make money out of this. The same reason they've picked up clubs like Girona in Spain. A good way to develop talent is put them in La Liga. You know, they have Yokohama as well.
We've seen a few clubs actually have ties with Spanish clubs as well. Because it works out to be, you know, a mutual relationship where they can benefit from one another.
Yeah.
Trading players, developing players at their academy. Sam Schofield, good day to you via Facebook. This
Right up,
comment
Sam.
From him, they recruit poorly, as in Melbourne City. No patience, perpetually in victory's shadow. They are a feeder club. Peter Freeman thinks City will finish fourth.
Yeah, probably about...
Hassan thinks they're going to win the league.
Hassan. Call from Hassan.
City first, he says. Hello.
I mean, you know, listen, we're making all these predictions. Someone's going to cut up a video in 27 weeks' time and go, listen how dumb you all were. Yeah, okay, maybe Hassan's right. Maybe they'll finish top. I personally don't think so. I agree with Commoner, who said they'll finish fourth.
Let's move on to their not-so-crosstown rivals, because we know that they share the same stadium and basically may as well just be the one club, effectively, because there's no tie to any one region. Apologies. Melbourne Victory. Kevin Muscat, still the coach. Last season they finished fourth, and then they won. They were crowned champions in an historic result, because nobody who's ever finished fourth has actually gone on to win the league in what was a very highly controversial grand final, by the way, when the VAR decided to cock up conveniently at that particular moment. So anyway.
Although I do know that apparently is not going to happen this year.
Oh, okay. Apparently they can say that with complete and utter conviction.
So the thing was, this was the explanation that I heard.
Correct.
The VAR, the system was, I guess, like the hardware of it had to be built at every single game. So they had to kind of put it all together at the final, right?
Out of the one hub, similar to what they do in the NRL.
Yep.
But that still doesn't eliminate the possibility similar of any kind of technological cock-ups.
That is true. You know, there could be a power failure anywhere. So, but I think it should be better this year.
All right. I hope it should be better.
Mm-hmm.
The people operating it should be better. But anyway, it's a VAR. What can you do? Key signings. Keske Honda. Ola Toivonen, very good pickup, by the way. Raul Baena.
Yep.
Then you've got Corey Brown as a familiar name. Storm Rue, Nick Ansell.
Yep.
Oh, man. I think they're going to be competitive once again. They're recruiting very well. But the big question is, Honda, is he going to deliver? Is he going to set the A-League on fire?
Yes, I think so.
Is that right?
If I had to guess, I would say yeah. Like,
taking a pun here.
32 years old, an unbelievably talented player. I mean, hopefully the environment around him's right. I'm sure Melbourne will accommodate him very well. You know, I think depending on how Muskie sets up his kind of team, I think they're going to be great. I'm really looking forward to watching Melbourne Victory. They obviously play City in the first game of the season, so Melbourne Derby,
huge.
Great way to start the league. And another thing, did you see the story on the World Game actually last week, which was Peter Crouch? He said, in my entire career, like 17 years playing in England, Premier League, the only player I was scared of, Kevin Muscat, right? And he said, Kevin...
was scared of Kevin Muscat. You just need to YouTube some of the things that he's done to a few players over the years. Everyone was terrified of him.
And I'm still a little scared of Kevin Muscat.
No, but you shouldn't be. Because let me tell you something about Muskie. And everybody has this interesting perception of him based on what they've seen in his footballing career. From having worked on the sidelines for 4 years, I will tell you there was not a single coach I enjoyed dealing with more than Muskie.
Muskie, yeah.
Absolute and utter gentleman. The kind of guy that would shake your hand, your camera guy's hand, your audio guy's hand before and after the interviews. Yeah. Was never ever feeling, he never made you feel like you were a bother if you had to come in the change room, which by the way, I'd never enjoyed doing. I think the change room is a private sanctity for the players.
Yeah, I agree.
I know that it's done a lot in NFL, and I know that we've recently taken this turn to doing it in football, but I don't like it. You don't see it happen in the Premier League, so I don't think we should be doing it either. That's their space, stay out of that space. But I will say, Muscat, absolute and utter gentleman.
Well, here's my question.
Go.
Because I feel like Muscat as a player, like those type of really hard, intimidating defenders, do they make them anymore? Because if you think about it, I was thinking there are three A-League coaches who fit that mold, and they are Tony Popovich, Kevin Muscat, and Mark Rudin. Three intimidating defenders. Three guys who are pretty scary. And
very
I want to know, can you think of, if there was going to be a fight and it was between those three and any three players now in the A-League, I think the coaches are going
to
win.
Well, they have to.
Like, they are, I mean, Muscat, Popper, Rudes. The three guys I did not want to mess around with, you know what I mean? So, anyway, Muscat still being famous in England for intimidating everyone, and there is some incredible vision on YouTube and in our article of Muscat, you know, causing all kinds of havoc.
Well, here's a question, and I like this one, from Benjamin Collins via Facebook. Good afternoon to you, Ben.
Benji, what's going on?
Benji? I don't know. Maybe Benji sounds more like a dog's name, doesn't it?
No, Benji Marshall, the rugby league player.
Yeah, but I don't know. Oh, you think of that. I think of Benji the dog.
Okay.
Maybe just Benjamin or Ben. Benjamin Collins, what do you prefer? Tell us. Anyway, do you think if Victory do not win the league with their signings, etc., the season will be classified as a failure?
If they don't challenge for the league.
Okay.
If they're second and they miss out by, you know, a couple of points, you'd think, okay, yeah, that was, they, you know, these things happen. Yeah. Especially if they make a run of it in the finals like they did last season. I do think, for sure, if they don't challenge for the league, yeah, of course, that'd be a massive failure. They've recruited the most, like, expensive player that we've had in years.
Jordan Minter, I'm about to do something that's very responsible. Don't you give us the wind-up, Pat Nugent. Go away. We're going to be here all day. I'm not going home. Corey, you can wait for dinner. Yeah. Jordan Minter, Lucy, what will you say if Bolt scores more than Honda? I'm going to do something really stupid now. There are witnesses. You're here. You via Facebook watching. You via Twitter from wherever you're watching around the world. If Usain Bolt starts in the A-League in a professional game and by the end of the season scores more goals than Keske Honda, an absolute legend of football, I will shave my head. There. I said it.
All right.
If that happens, I will actually physically shave my head. Yes. There. Now what?
Man, what are you talking about? If that's going to happen, that's not going to happen. He's not even. The only way that happens is if, for whatever reason, Honda does his knee in minute one of the Melbourne Derby, is out for the season, and then somehow Bolt gets in.
If both of them play full seasons and this all happens how it's being depicted, then I will shave my head.
Yeah.
All right.
That's.
Next club.
The next club is, by alphabetical order, is Newcastle Jets.
Actual alphabetical order.
Newcastle Jets.
Sweat again. See, it's whenever the Bolt thing comes up, I start to feel my head itching. You've got... I'm very irritated. Maybe I do need to shave my head. Newcastle Jets, coach Ernie Merrick, last season, they finished second. They were grand finalists. I saw some comments coming through from a Jets fan saying that they were robbed. I tend to sort of feel like you were.
Of course they were. The VAR, which was meant to be in place, didn't work. You got robbed.
How much time I had for the Jets last season.
Yeah, that was so nice to watch. That was so nice to watch.
Beautiful football. ball. They were working as a team. You know what? You could see that the pride of the hunter had been restored. Yeah. The fans turning up in droves. It was such a beautiful fairy tale story. I loved it.
The only thing I'll say on the Jets is they obviously lost Naboo halfway through last season, which I think affected them. And they've also lost Pato Rodriguez, who I know was only here for a short while, but I thought he was a very exciting player. And I thought he filled that void a little bit that Naboo left. So.
And that creativity. Yeah. So
I think it's going to be very interesting how Vargas goes this season. I only had the injury last season, so we've missed a lot of him.
I think Vargas will be very beneficial.
And I think Petradas, can he live up to those kind of high standards that he set last season? I think he will. I love watching Dimi Petradas play. But, you know, let's see how it goes for the Jets.
I think it'll be interesting. I'd like to see them do well. Oh, yeah, that's true. Also, Viet Ton via Facebook, thanks to that, they lost Riley as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So two City. Yeah, another young Australian. Go on there.
Clinton Aspie, best manager Jets have signed since A-League started.
Ernie Merrick?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
They've had some torrid ones.
They've had, I'm just trying to go through it. I mean, they won the title with Gary Van Egmond.
Yes.
But, you know, that kind of didn't work out in the end. Yeah, so he's doing really well. I think he has really developed the young talent there, got the best out of, you know, a lot of those players who, you know, there's a lot of players in the A-League. Naboo and Petratus are great examples. They start off at, like, Sydney and Melbourne. It doesn't work out for them. They have to go somewhere else, whether it be, like, I think Naboo went to Malaysia or something like that.
Correct.
Petratus was going to Brisbane. And they come back, and just because it didn't work out for them at a young age doesn't mean it's never going to work out for them, right? And it just takes the right coach, the right environment to really get it out of them. And
very
so,
good points, Stolly. Very good.
Yeah, so I think Merrick has done that, and it's going to be interesting to see who's going to do that this season.
Where do you
which
think
club.
They're going to finish?
The Jets, third.
Third?
Yeah.
Okay, I like it. Let's go on to the next club, Perth Glory. New coach, Tony Popovich. Yeah. Hello, last season they finished eighth. Key signings. Very decent, I will say. Matthew Spiranovic makes his return to Australia. Jason Davidson, Chris Economides, Tomislav Vrsela, Ivan Franic, Fabio Ferreira, Juande, and Brendan Chantalab.
Popper loves to get in the Croats, doesn't he?
Oh, Popper. Take care of his Croat mates. No judgment. I mean, there's not much I can
Spiranovic,
say.
Franic,
Marcella,
you know, we're not.
Chantalab.
All right, I think Tony Popovich at Perth Glory, I don't know how many games they play at home. I'm going to say they play about 14 games at home, 13 games at home. Eight of those will be 1-0 wins. This will be the Atletico Madrid of... It'll be a tough away game.
So you're saying that Tony Popovich is the Diego Simeone of the
A-League? Oh, he knows it. He thinks it. Why is he dressed all in black?
Hang on a second, though. Here's a spanner to throw into the works. Yeah. Because then when he got the Spanish influence at the Wanderers...
Yeah.
He changed his style of football. He started to play more proactive, high-pressing football.
Yeah, and then he kind of reverted back to
so
what he knew when he
went. So he's going back to Diego Simeone Atletico style?
You know who tries to revert to high-pressing, attacking football every year and then reverts? Diego Simeone.
All right.
He starts out at the start of the season, oh, yeah, we're going to be more attacking, Griezmann, Lamar, we're going to get them all playing. And then, it's not going well. Boom, 1-0 wins, 1-0 wins. Perth Glory will win 8 games, 1-0.
Comment from Nicholas McKercher by
good name.
Facebook. Good afternoon to you, Nicholas. Perth are in serious, capital letters, serious trouble. Tony Popovich can't manage a final third.
Interesting, but I will say this. They still have Diego Castro, and Diego Castro is a year older, but there is no player that I've enjoyed.
Federico Piovacari, that's all I'm going to
say. Yeah, that was... Now, even Papa knows.
He did sign some honking players up front. They did have trouble. They really but did. Towards the end of his tenure, it was not going so well.
I think in the past, I think the Glory have had a very good front line. They've actually just struggled kind of defensively and in midfield. So I think Papa's going to sort that out, as he always does at his clubs. I'm very interested to see how Diego Castro plays. If he can still get the best out of Castro, then they will be good.
Season last time around.
Yeah, but he's still, honestly, for me, last couple of seasons, him and Ninkovic have been the most talented players in the league.
Aren't they? They are beautiful footballers.
Castro, I'd watch
really,
every
really
week.
Wonderful footballers. Yeah. Sam Schofield, Perth will do very, very well under Popper. It will be like Western Sydney Wanderers' first season mixed with Perth's NSL crowd.
Wait, are you in marketing? That's a good sell. That's
it is a
good,
very sell.
I rate that. All right, we're going to be watching Perth go.
If you grew up on the NSL diet, which I didn't, it fed my soul very well, thank you very much. I loved the Perth Glory crowd.
The best.
The Desvitovsky days.
It's a shame they haven't got to that level, actually.
That was brilliant. But, you know, perhaps some people are saying that Popper can get them back there. And I think that club has needed a bit more stability. It's needed a bit more discipline. How the players react, it should be interesting. But
first game
question,
against the Wanderers, actually. So that's going to be very interesting.
That is huge. Props to the people that sorted out the fixture list there.
Good fixtures, good fixtures.
Can Perth make the six?
Yeah, I mean, 1-0 wins, they'll get there. All they'll get there for sure.
Sydney FC, what an interesting prospect. Last season finished first, we're looking to back it up, but they were semi-finalists in the end. Now, key signings, we've touched on them before. Adam Lefondre, CM De Jong, Daniel De Silva, which is also good. And good Trent Bahaja, absolutely gutted for the kids. News came out yesterday that he did his ACL.
I mean, it happens. It happens. And, you know, we wish him the best. But, you know, this is football. And this is, like, the horrible thing. You know, players, they sign for different things. Remember Bernie Abini went to Club Bruges and did it in his first...
Broke his leg, I believe.
Yeah, did in his first training session. So very unfortunate for Bahaja. But, you know, that's the world we live in.
Adrian Arciulli, you have more chest hair than I do on my head, Nick Stoll. Nick Stoll, that's probably accurate. But Adrian Arciulli, you barely have any hairs on your head. So thank you for tuning in. He sits just behind us, Adrian Arciulli. If you're worried about us being aggressive or potentially bullying an SBS colleague of ours...
Yeah.
He
was that the A-League launch? We'll have his thing on tonight, 7:30 news. No, 6:30 news. I'm terrible at promos.
Just don't look for the hair.
Yeah.
Sydney FC.
Yeah.
Hassan Bertan, Sydney to two.
To two? Sydney to two.
Two. As in Sydney 2-2? What do you mean,
Sydney
Hassan?
To finish second?
Finish second? Or Alex Kosofsky, more pressure on Corica than anyone else at Sydney FC. Couldn't agree more.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you're taking over a team that was extremely successful under Graham Arnold. You have a very good squad, I think. You know, Mozievski is a big loss, but De Jong is a good replacement. Yeah.
Scored goals for fun.
Bobo, big loss, but you'd think Lafondre is a good replacement, right? They have filled those roles well, and so I expect them to be them and Victory challenging for the title.
Them and Victory challenging for the interesting. A few comments about Sydney FC. Vince Pell, will Sydney FC finally play some youth? Because that was perhaps the biggest criticism of the Sky Blues under Graham Arnold, is that they didn't actually, well, he didn't, and the coaching staff didn't have a preference to play any younger players, and then that forced Arnie to come out publicly and say, look, this isn't a development league, which then opened up Pandora's box, and we all started going cack-a-doodle and having an opinion on it. Because, let's be honest, youth development is a big issue in this country at the moment. But... Stephen Leskovac, again, De Jong is a massive signing.
Big
Sam
signing.
Schofield, stadium drama / change of coach plus last...
very good point about the stadium. The stadium...
Because we saw what it did to the Wanderers and then playing at Spotless, which is a honking football stadium, by the way. The GWS Giants, you can go and play there all you like. It's a perfect AFL venue, but it is not a football stadium.
Is there a... We got to stop putting football games at oval grounds, basically.
Terrible.
It's just too far away from the thing. So I think it's going to be an issue. I think CNFC are a very high-quality team. But that's a very good point from the person who made that comment. I do think, actually, it will affect them this year. Because it does change. Players are used to coming to the same venue, everything. And they're very kind of calm in their own environment. And it's going to be a new thing. We saw it affect Tottenham in their first time at Wembley.
I was just about to say, but look. You know, they've adjusted well to Wembley, and now they're going to have to adjust again to their new home once it is finished. I mean, far out, hurry up already. All right, last club before we have to wrap up the show. We've been gibbering for quite a while.
Yeah.
I do like gibbering with you, though.
Ah, it's good. We have a good jibber.
Gibbering.
Yeah.
I mean, we got the wind up like 15 minutes ago.
We'll have more jibbers coming your way. We'll have podcasts.
Just not next Monday because you're at a wedding.
I will invite you to the wedding.
Will you?
Yes.
No.
It's on the Gold
Coast. I can't. I have to work. No, I'm
what
not.
Gonna do?
What do you think I'm gonna not covered Chelsea v Man United come to your wedding?
That game is actually amazing. Actually, I didn't even know that was on. Oh my God. Now I have to find a way to at 10:30 during the wedding, just pretend I'm dancing off somewhere.
And then you get your
stream it.
App out.
Yeah.
And you watch
stream it.
It.
Yeah, exactly. I'm gonna pretend I'm filming everyone. No, guys, I'm taking photos. I'll just be watching it the whole time.
That's very smart.
Sorry if anyone is going to the wedding.
Groom are watching this and they disinvite you.
Yeah, maybe.
What did you buy them?
Well, I can't tell you that. It's a surprise.
Was it off the registry or did you make it up? Or were you just doing the walk thing and giving them cash?
Thanks, Freya, for organising the present. I don't know what we got them.
Yes. Freya Noble, his lovely, lovely girlfriend, who has written into us before. Freya, you're a legend. I've got time for her. Good egg.
Oh, yeah.
Why don't you bring her in one day?
Because she has to work.
Yeah, that's true. Sorry, Freya.
Shout out Channel 9.
Channel 9. Wellington Phoenix, the final club, now that we are going in
alphabetical. I'm excited about Wellington.
Alphabetical order. Coach.
They're not the final club.
Rodan, first A-League gig. Last season, they finished ninth, the Phoenix, that is.
Yeah.
There aren't all that high hopes for them this season, with the greatest of respect. Key signings, Stephen Taylor, Philip Courto, David Williams, Mitch Nichols, and Michael Kopczynski.
Yep. I think they're going to do well. I like Rudes. Rudes obviously worked with us quite a few times here at SBS, and he's a very intelligent guy, so I always think that's a very good sign. He was part of a very successful Sydney FC team, so that thing. He was a very good coach with Sydney United. He won the national, I think, NPL title with them, right? So all those signs point to me, him doing well.
Benjamin Collins via Facebook, Phoenix to win the league.
All right, Benj. I thought I was pumping him up. That's you've gone
well,
one step.
A lot of respect for Rudes. Yeah. What he's achieved, you know, at NPL level, but yeah, of course, going into this job with the Phoenix was always going to be a massive uphill battle because of the turmoil going on at the club. All the disarray and disenchantment around. Do they belong in the A-League? Don't they? I do believe that this is their final... Is this their final year on the agreement? Correct me if I'm wrong.
Because correct or if they're wrong, because I have no idea.
Because they only signed for two.
Is it 2021?
They only gave them two because... I mean, Facebook is right in. Tell us.
I have a feeling it might be to 2021. That's my understanding. But anyway, I think New Zealand, it's a very tough away trip. I think they're going to do well. I think Rudes...
gave them four, but normally that, yeah, I don't know.
I think Rudes is going to get the best out of them. I'm excited to see David Williams back in the A-League. He was scoring a lot of goals in Hungary when he was over there. So let's see how he goes. Steve Taylor, ex-Premier League player with Newcastle United. He should shore things up at the back. I'm very interested to see how they go. And actually, I believe we'll be speaking to Mark Rudin this week. So we'll have an interview on our website. So check that out when it comes out.
I was going to answer the phone. My best friend's calling me. She's finished work.
What? What? She does not watch it?
I'll just answer the phone and say, sorry, darling, I'm just in the middle of something.
No, I think Wellington are going to do well. Actually, they also signed Max Burgess, who, you know, full disclosure, is a mate of mine. So, Max, you're going to be amazing. I can see it. He was a top player in the NPL last season.
He was. For Sydney Olympic. Quinton Aspie, we need a second Brisbane team. We're getting a bit off the beaten track here, but
we do need a second Brisbane team.
Are they ready for it, though?
No. Well, I don't know if they need to come in this round of expansion, but we need a second Brisbane team, but we also need a third and fourth Sydney team. We need a third and fourth Melbourne team. We need a second Adelaide team. I think we should have derbies in every city.
I like that. Derbies in every city would be ideal.
Ideally, over the next 20 years or whatever, we should be aiming for a 16 comp league, I think.
Yeah, it's got to get there eventually, but I don't know that we're ready for that either yet. We talk about now we're opening the box again and I'm starting to sweat. I did have in my notes here to talk about the UEFA Nations League and the Internationals wrap, but I don't want to do that because I've already said that I think this UEFA Nations League is an attempt to get us excited about friendlies where none of us really give a damn, although respect to Gibraltar for what they did. Let's talk very quickly before we wrap up about Thierry Henry. Monaco coach on a three-year deal. Loved what he did with Roberto Martinez, Belgium. But how do you think he's going to go at Monaco, a club with, you know, some very good pedigree in terms of the players that they've developed over the years and had to say goodbye to, Kylian Mbappe being one of them. But how do you think he's going to go France in Ligue 1?
I think he's going to go well. I don't think he's going to be able to, like, knock PSG off, like, first spot. But I think he's a very intelligent player. He's worked with some very good coaches. And I think he's quite ambitious. So I think, you know, that all works in his favour. Yep. I do think that Monaco were very harsh to sack Jardim, who I think is a great coach. Jardim won the league, right, a season or two ago with Monaco against PSG, right? Mm-hmm. He got into the semi-finals of the Champions League, right? He developed some great young talent.
Yeah, but then the squad got completely cut after that.
So, like, what is he meant to do? He loses 9 of his best players. They don't replace them with top players. I think Jardim is a great coach. And actually, if I was Manchester United, I would take the risk of Mourinho. We know, okay, they won 3-2 against Newcastle the last game. It's going to go bad, whether it be this month, next month, or at the end of the season. It's not going to work out. He's not going to turn it around. Jardim already worked with Martial, has a proven record of getting the best out of young talent, which I think Manchester United need to do.
So, and he's an unbelievable. You want him to go to Man U?
I think any club, in fact, I would say any club like Bayern, like Manchester United, like potentially Real Madrid, that are kind of on the lookout.
Are they already on the lookout?
They're on the lookout for a new coach already. Niko Kovac is struggling big time. Any of these clubs that are on the lookout, I think Jardim is a top coach.
All right. Well, I'd happily have him anywhere, to be quite honest. Except not at Liverpool, because I'm very happy with my coach as it stands. How about this for a game that we are bringing you this Saturday? All right, forget the UEFA Nations League. That's done. The international break is over. I had my family in town. It was all nice and lovely, but it's...
The Socceroos are playing tomorrow, but then the international break is over.
Yeah. Then the international break is over, and we get back to the business of the Premier League, which returns this Saturday night. Coming to your screens, we are absolutely buzzing for this from 10 p.m. Chelsea taking on Manchester United. Mourinho back to the bridge.
Yeah.
After all this pressure, after all these discussions that have been going on around the Red Devils and him in particular, his relationship with the players, is the writing on the wall? Is he going to stay at the club? Do the board back him? Don't they? This is going to be a big game.
By the way, how happy did Pogba look to be back with his French national team teammates? Oh, didn't he look like he was enjoying football again?
He looked like a totally different
person. Listen, if United start as badly as they did against Newcastle, Chelsea will not let him get back into the game, that's for sure. Hazard is in unbelievable form, right? Chelsea look incredible. They haven't had the hardest run of fixtures, but, you know, I think it's going to be really interesting. I'm backing Chelsea to win this. I think
you're backing Chelsea to win it?
Yep, I think.
Or could this be Peter Freeman reckons Chelsea win 3-1?
Yep.
Jordan Minter, Chelsea v Manchester United prediction, Lucy and Nick. You've already given it?
Well maybe... 3-0. I mean, United played Spurs. United played Spurs at home and lost 3-0.
Yeah.
So, and that was really the only big team that United has faced so far. So.
But then the interesting thing was that happened in August. So after they lost to Spurs, then they went on a decent run. Then the result happened against Wolves, that draw. Then they went on and lost to West Ham.
Yeah.
And it all just seems to capitulate from there on out. They had the result against Derby County. They got knocked out of the League Cup. So
Chelsea 3-0.
Terrifying. Clinton Aspie, Sardi football, amazing. I'm a massive, massive fan of Sardi's, by the way. Alex Kosovsky, Chelsea win and Mourinho gets sacked.
Oh, I don't know if they'll sack him off a loss away to Chelsea. That seems a bit harsh, but he will inevitably get sacked.
But this perhaps sums up what you're thinking. Daniel Mehta, Chelsea comfortable win, Mourinho on the brink.
Yes, that's the great summation.
Jordan Minter, United to win 1-0, are Mourinho special. And that's always the danger with
Wasn't
him,
he the guy
it?
Who said the Bolt's going to score more than Honda?
No,
I don't know.
He was taking the piss, bless him. Everyone knows that it's a sore point now, so all I've seen is comments coming through about Bolt.
All right.
Fair play. I like it, Facebookers and Twitterers. I like a bit of friendly banter and a bit of friendly fire, so keep it up. If you want to see me scratch my head and get horribly uncomfortable and start to sweat at the thought of it and get very incensed, then by all means, keep bringing him up. Corey Aquilina, imagine Mourinho getting sacked at the bridge.
But like literally in the tunnel. You know, Abramovich did it to Ancelotti 1 year.
Oh yeah,
just sacked him in the tunnel.
He is terrifying. Let's just let it be known as one final point though that I cannot feel comfortable about. I do lean more towards Chelsea because of how good they've been recently.
Yeah.
But I just know that Mourinho has it in his repertoire to go, and they've had a very good record away this season so far. But he has it in his repertoire to go and play these games and to jag like a 1-0 ugly win. He's got it in him.
They beat City 3-2 last season when City were about to win the title. So it could happen. I don't think it will. The main thing is it's a massive game. It's at a great time. 10:30, wherever you are, if you're at a wedding.
Tune in at 10 p.m. to hear us gibber about it.
Yeah. The 10 p.m.
There's not
a promo that I've done that I've actually got right at this stage.
No, that's okay. But, you know, you can come back when you like. And in fact, you're scheduled to come back every week now. Except for next Monday, I'll keep bringing it up because he's going to a wedding.
Yeah, anyway.
Where are getting married?
On the Gold Coast somewhere.
You don't know. Is it one of Freya's friends?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, so that's why you've got absolutely no idea. What are you wearing?
A
suit? Is it that kind of a wedding?
Yeah. What else do you wear?
Well, I don't know. Some guy, you know, sometimes it's a more casual kind of like...
No. I'm wearing a suit.
What colour is it?
Grey, I think.
Look how irritated you are me by me asking.
Yeah, Bolt. It took me about Bolt.
Shut up, but you're going to piss me off again.
Yeah.
All right, look. Anyway, just tune in to watch that because we're very excited about the fact that we do have this game.
It's a massive game.
Fresh off the international break. Very excited. By the way, go to the Socceroos. We want to see them do well. We want to see them do well under Arnie. It's a new era, a new time, a very exciting time in Australian football for us to look forward and be excited by the future. So we wish them all the very best. Of course, they are taking on Q8 in the very early hours of the morning. For all of the stories that we have discussed today, by all means, head to the World Game websites to find so much more content than you bargained for. We've got opinion pieces, we've got video content, and all the news stories, as I said, that we've discussed today.
Yeah, Socceroos highlights will be on first thing in the morning.
How nice. Are you doing that?
No, Jono is doing it, and he's even better than me than my job, so shout out that.
Is he?
100%. What was going to happen is you're probably not going to get up at 3:30 in the morning to watch the soccer. You probably woke up at like...
Why would you say that? How can you assume that? These are patriotic people. These are football people that are joining
us. I seen the ratings to 3:30 a.m. All right, you guys, yeah, I'm going to get up. The alarm goes off. You go, yeah, yeah, I'll just snooze it for 2 seconds. You're out.
Are you getting up?
Yeah, of course I'm getting up. I'm not even going to bed. I'll do the night shift here and keep going. But
how are you going to just multiple coffinos?
Yeah. Big fan of the espresso machine. Espresso or a macchiato?
Espresso or a macchiato?
Yeah, don't have too much milk. Why? Have a milkshake if you want milk.
What decides your preference, though? Like, if you are going for an espresso over a macchiato, why?
The macchiato is the one I like to have at the start of the day. And then after that, it's just espresso, 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 espresso.
How many do you have a day?
Like 4. I've got to keep up with your energy.
With my energy? I'm not on caffeine anymore.
Ooh.
I banned
it. Natural.
I banned it.
Really?
Yeah,
why?
I just thought I'd need a break.
Yeah, well,
I came
back
from Russia, we were smashing like, it is disgusting. We were having like 10 of those instant coffees a day. It tasted like sewage by the end of it.
And there you go, audience. She has withdrawals and that's why she's sweating so much. So she should get back on the coffee.
Caramel latte. Can I tell you something, Daniel? That is the first coffee I ever tried.
Yeah, of course.
As a 15-year-old girl. Now the show's gone to shit. Barring the fact that my mum used to actually give me sips of espresso as a kid, you know, and they all thought it was funny, like that Turkish coffee, those crazy Croatian women. Let's give her some Turkish coffee, see how funny it is. Joke's on her, I didn't sleep all night. Caramel latte.
Yeah, it's the gateway drug of coffees. You know, you have like a thing that tastes like a milkshake, and then you just end up being like me and having 4 espressos. That's it.
All right, I've done the promos.
Yep.
I've refused to talk about UEFA League of Nations. I've gotten angry about Usain Bolt. We've discussed the A-League, which starts this week, and I'm actually really excited, by the way.
W-League coming soon.
W-League coming soon. Like, there is a lot. And by the way, we are showing the W-League this season, too, on Viceland. So make sure that you tune in for that. We had our fabulous journalist out there last night sitting down. I looked at some of the footage, interviews with Sam Kerr, Ellie Carpenter, all of your favourites, Kaya Simon, Mini, Katrina Gorry. It was great to see.
Honestly, they're the best to talk to.
They're unreal because that's the difference. They're very forthcoming, they're personable, very likeable. It's all good stuff. We spoke about
very competitive season.
We spoke about what's potentially going to happen for Jose Mourinho.
Yeah.
Which, who knows, writing could be on the wall.
Did anyone come up with 3 players that could beat Muscat, Popovic, and Rudes in a fight?
No.
Nah, you can't do it. It's unbelievable.
I don't know. Maybe we'll save that for next week when you're not here. I'm joking.
Guys, I miss you.
I'm just going to miss you. Anyway, look, all right, thanks, guys. We've really enjoyed your company today. I know we've gotten a bit cackadoodle myself.
Yeah.
You've been great, Stolly. I've got off the wayside. I got a text from Michael Tomalaris, who sits just behind us, too, who wanted to say how good a job you're doing, too, by the way.
Cheers, Tomo.
Cheers, Tomo.
Oh, no, he's not there.
Oh, no, he's not.
Well, that makes sense. He would have just come and said it. Thanks, Tom.
All right, guys, thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to have your company via Facebook or Twitter from wherever you are joining us around the country or around the world. I saw a couple of people writing to us from Italy, which is very, very cool.
Love that, man.
It has been fantastic.
What time is it in Italy? Go to sleep.
No, they're tuning in. They want to have a jibber with us. What's wrong with it?
Too many espressos.
These idiots are not going to be here next week, so we need to find a replacement. So, I don't know.
Send your applications.
Send your applications. It would be good. But, yeah, it's time to go. We got the wrap-up a while ago, but that's it. From me, Stolich, and the entire team here at The World Game, thanks for joining us for our The World Game live session on Monday, and we'll see you again next week.